Macmillan Audio presents Fractured Fables, containing A Spindle Splintered and A Mirror Mended by Alix E. Harrow. Read by Amy Landon, with an introduction from the author.
For everyone who deserves a better story than the one they have. Introduction. I can't usually identify the moment an idea arrived, but this one came to me in the parking lot of the Cinemark Theater in Richmond, Kentucky, on a December afternoon in 2018, about 8 minutes after leaving a matinee of Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse. Forgive me if you've heard me tell this story before. In my defense, that's sort of the theme of this essay. Spider-Verse was and remains the best superhero movie I've ever seen because it understands how many superhero movies I've already seen. It knows how many times I've seen Peter Parker bitten by the spider and Uncle Ben shot, how many different actors I've seen under the mask. It's self-aware, but not snide, subversive, but not shrill. It doesn't ignore all its previous iterations or despise them. It gives them speaking lines. And it's just so fun. Every frame is saturated with a sort of gleeful, giddy mischief. You can almost hear the creators cackling to themselves. Please imagine this as a monologue delivered to my husband. He is listening, but he is also guiding me gently toward the car because I have forgotten where I parked. It wasn't that I'd been a huge comic book kid, honestly. If anything, I'd been a fairy tale kid. I grew up on little golden book versions of Disney movies, followed by my mom's leather-bound book of Grimm's fairy tales, the one with full-page illustrations protected by filmy, translucent sheets of wax paper, followed in turn by the sudden and delightful explosion of young adult fairy tale retellings, Levine, Yolen, Marillier, McKinley. At that point, my two remaining neurons collided, and I said, I want to Spider-Verse a fairy tale. My husband said that sounded great and asked if my seatbelt was buckled. It was not. Of course, fairy tale retellings have been done before. A fairy tale is a retelling almost by definition, a story that has been told before and will be told again over and over for a purpose that shifts according to time and place. The Grimms retold them to help construct a unified national identity for the nascent German state and to make money. The Victorians retold them to instill specific gender and class values in their children and to lay claim to a broader white European heritage, and to make money. Disney put fairy tales on the screen almost exclusively to make money, which worked because the Victorian project had been so successful that by 1937, every Midwestern American kid knew Snow White's name, and because she so perfectly embodied the purity, perseverance, and passivity of the ideal American girl. I'm making it sound like fairy tale retellings are inherently hegemonic, but by now they've been thoroughly subverted, revised, reinvented, reclaimed, deconstructed and reconstructed, canceled and resurrected. The princesses have rescued themselves. The witches have been redeemed. The princes have been introduced to the concept of consent. A feminist fairy tale retelling is no longer necessary or long overdue, thank God. It's just Tuesday. And yet, we're still not done with them. We keep circling back like fictional murderers to the scene of the crime. I think when we want to make sense of the new, we reach for the oldest tools. I think our favorite songs are the ones we've heard before. I think we like stories best when they echo. That's what A Spindle Splintered and A Mirror Mended are about, really. The stories we keep telling and the echoes between them. I hope it reminds you of books you've read before, but doesn't bore you. I hope you know the ending, but are still surprised. I hope you can hear me, faintly, cackling to myself on every page.
Macmillan Audio presents A Spindle Splintered.
One. Sleeping Beauty is pretty much the worst fairy tale any way you slice it. It's aimless and amoral and chauvinist as shit. It's the fairy tale that feminist scholars cite when they want to talk about women's passivity in historical narratives. She literally sleeps through her own climax, as my favorite gender studies professor used to say. Double entendre fully intended. Jezebel ranked it as the least woke Disney movie of all time, which in a world where The Little Mermaid exists is really saying something. Ariel might have given up her voice for a dude, but Aurora barely uses hers. She has a grand total of 18 lines in her own movie, fewer than the prince, the villain, or any of the individual fairy godmothers. Even among the other nerds who majored in folklore, Sleeping Beauty is nobody's favorite. Romantic girls like Beauty and the Beast, vanilla girls like Cinderella, goth girls like Snow White. Only dying girls like Sleeping Beauty. I don't remember the first time I saw Sleeping Beauty. Probably in some waiting room or a hospital bed, interrupted by blipping machines and chirpy nurses. But I remember the first time I saw Arthur Rackham's illustrations. It was my 6th birthday, after cake, but before my evening pills. The second-to-last gift was a cloth-bound copy of Grimm's Fairy Tales from Dad. I was flipping through it, pretending to be a little more excited than I actually was because, even at 6, I knew my parents needed a lot of protecting. When I saw her, a woman in palest watercolor lying artfully across her bed, eyes closed, one hand dangling white and limp, throat arched, black ink shadows looming like crows around her. She looked beautiful. She looked dead. Later I'd find out that's how every Sleeping Beauty looks, hot and blonde, and dead, lying in a bed that might be a bier. I touched the curve of her cheek, the white of her palm, half hypnotized. But I wasn't really a goner until I turned the page. She was still hot and blonde, but no longer dead. Her eyes were wide open, blue as June, defiantly alive. And it was like, I don't know, a beacon being lit, a flint being struck in my chest. Charmaine Baldwin, best, only, friend, says Sleeping Beauty was my first crush, and she's not totally wrong. But it was more than that. It was like looking into a mirror and seeing my face reflected brighter and better. It was my own shitty story, made mythic and grand and beautiful. A princess cursed at birth, a sleep that never ends, a dying girl who refused to die. Objectively, I'm aware our stories aren't that similar. Wicked fairies are thin on the ground in rural Ohio, and I'm not suffering from a curse so much as fatal teratogenic damage caused by corporate malfeasance. If you drew a Venn diagram between me and Briar Rose, the overlap would be 1. Doomed to die young. 2. Hot in a fragile, consumptive way. 3. Named after flowers. I mean, look, I have a folklore degree. I'm aware that Sleeping Beauty's name has ranged from Talia to Aurora to Zelandine. Do not Google that last one. But the Grimms called her Briar Rose, and my name is Zinnia Gray. So just let me have this one, all right? I'm not even blonde. After that birthday, I was pretty obsessed. It's one of the rules for dying girls. If you like something, like it hard, because you don't have a lot of time to waste. So I had Sleeping Beauty bedsheets and Sleeping Beauty toothpaste and Sleeping Beauty Barbies. My bookshelves filled with Grimm and Lang and then McKinley and Levine and Yolen. I read every retelling and every picture book. I bought a DVD set of the original Alvin and the Chipmunks run just to watch episode 85B, The Legend of Sleeping Brittany, which was just as awful as every other chipmunk-related piece of media. By the time I was 12, I'd seen 1,000 beauties prick their fingers on 1,000 spindles, 1,000 castles swallowed by 1,000 rose hedges. I still wanted more. I graduated high school 2 years early. Another one of the rules for dying girls is move fast, and went straight into the Department of Folk Studies and Anthropology at Ohio University. 7 semesters later, I had an impractical degree, a 200-page thesis on representations of disability and chronic illness in European folklore, and less than a year left to live. Dad would cry if he heard me say that. Mom would invent some urgent task in her flower beds, tending things that weren't going to die on her. Charm would roll her eyes and tell me to quit being such a little bitch about it. It takes a particular kind of tough to pick the dying girl to be your best friend. All of them would remind me that I don't know exactly how long I've got, that generalized Roseville malady is still largely unstudied, that new treatments are being tested as we speak, etc., etc. But the fact is that nobody with GRM has made it to 22. Today is my 21st birthday. My relatives are all over for dinner, and my grandma is drinking like a fish, if fish drank scotch, and my worst aunt is badgering Dad about crystals and alternative therapies. My cheeks hurt from fake smiling, and my poor parents are doing their very best to keep the celebration from feeling like a wake. And I have never been more relieved in my short, doomed life to feel the buzz of my phone on my hip. It's Charm, of course. Happy birthday. And then, meet me at the tower, princess. Towers, like wicked fairies, are pretty rare in Ohio. We mostly have pole barns and Jesus-y billboards and endless squares of soybeans. Roseville has a tower, though. There's an old state penitentiary out on Route 32, abandoned in the 60s or 70s. Most of it is hulking brick buildings with smashed-out windows and mediocre graffiti, obviously haunted. But there's an old watchtower standing on one corner. It should be exactly as creepy as the rest of the place, poisoned by decades of human misery and institutional injustice. But instead, it looks lost, out of time and place. Like a landlocked lighthouse. Like a fairy tale tower, somehow washed up on the shores of the real world. It's where I always planned to die, in my morbid preteen phase. I imagined I would dramatically rip the IVs from my veins and limp down the country road, suffocating in my own treacherous proteins, collapsing gothically and attractively just as I reached the highest room. My hair would fan into a black halo around the bloodless white of my face, and whoever found me would be forced to pause and sigh at the sheer picturesque tragedy of the thing. Eat your heart out, Rackham. God, middle schoolers are intense. I no longer plan to make anyone discover my wasted body because I'm not a monster, but I still visit the tower sometimes. It's where I went after high school to ditch track practice and get high with Charm. It's where I made out for the first time, also with Charm, before I instituted dying girl rule number 3. It's where I go when I can't stand to be in my own house, my own skin, for another second. I switch off the headlights and coast the last quarter mile down Route 32, because the old penitentiary is technically private property, upon which trespassers will be shot and park in the grass. I pop my 8 o'clock handful of pills and make my way down the rutted lane that leads to the old watchtower. I'm not surprised to see the orange flicker of light in the windows. I figure Charm dragged a few of our friends, her friends, if we're being honest, out here for a party, rather than hosting it in the hazardous waste zone she calls an apartment. I bet she brought red plastic cups and a half keg, because she wants me to have a legit 21st birthday experience. Completely ignoring the fact that alcohol interferes with at least 3 of my meds because that's the kind of friend she is. But when I step through the tower door, it doesn't smell like beer and weed and mildew. It smells luxuriant, heady, so sweet I feel like an old-timey cartoon character hooked by the nostrils. I waft up the staircase. There are murmuring voices above me, faint strains of very uncharm-like music growing louder. The highest room in the tower has always been empty, except for the detritus left by time and teenagers. Windblown leaves, beer tabs, cicada shells, a condom or two. It's not empty tonight. There are strings of pearled lights crisscrossing the ceiling, and long swaths of blushing fabric draped over the windows. A dozen or so people, wearing the kind of gauzy fairy wings that come from the year-round Halloween store at the mall. Roses absolutely everywhere, bursting from buckets and mason jars and Carlo Rossi jugs. And in the very center of the room, looking dusty and rickety and somehow grand, a spinning wheel. That's when I recognize the song that's playing. Once Upon a Dream, the main theme from Disney's Sleeping Beauty, a waltzing melody stolen straight from Tchaikovsky's ballet. I am way, way too old for a Sleeping Beauty-themed birthday. I can't stop smiling. Oh, Charm, you didn't. I 100% did. Charm passes her PBR to the girl beside her and flings herself at me. She does a little...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.